from the core of the believers, from the house of the believers, who have died. And according to Paul, he says, those who have fallen asleep. And if a person is asleep, it means that's this. That person will wake up at the proper time. He says, about those who have fallen asleep, we have friends, we have relatives, we have many other brethren and brothers in the house of the Lord who already have fallen asleep, both this year, last year, all this year before. They have fallen asleep. And this is the assurance that we have as brethren in the house of the Lord. If Christ lives, we will also fall asleep. The Paul said, the Paul who was speaking at that time, he was alive. And the Paul who spoke this, he's no longer alive. He has fallen asleep as well. Somewhat about 2,000 years back, he is still asleep. And he says, I do not want to be you to be ignorant concerning those who have fallen asleep, lest you sorrow as others who have no hope. Lest you grieve like the rest of mankind. Lest you grieve, you mourn, you sorrow like the rest of mankind. He's bringing here an element of distinction, of separation. And in particular, he's addressing the church. And he's separating the church from the rest of the whole society. He says, I do not want you to grieve like the rest of mankind. And he uses adjective to say, who have no hope. With us, as Christians, as believers in the Lord, as we have given our life to Christ, we hold on to this hope. And this is the hope that we have in Christ, that when he appears, we will be like him. And this is the hope that we have in the Lord, that will appear one day, and will meet him in the sky. And this is the hope that we have as Christians. And Paul is saying, I do not want you to be ignorant of this hope. We have hope. I'm challenging you both now and today that do not allow a situation in your life where you drop down the hope material embedded in your spirit when you receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. Hope must go down. Hope must spread out. Hope must carry you on. It's a hope that sustains us. When we wait for the coming of Jesus Christ, we wait in hope. This is the hope that sustains our kind of faith in the Lord. But Paul says, as a distinction, the rest of mankind, the rest of others who have no hope, the people out there, outside the body of Christ, who have no hope, who when things come like this, which is happening now in the world over, they are frustrated. They don't know where to go, whether to go forward or backwards. They are held up in deep frustrations. And why? Because there's no hope. But with you, it must be different. Listen to me. With you, it must be different. I say I'm preaching to the Christian believers. With us, world, remember what we used to see. This world is not our home. We are passing through. We are passers-by. Yes, we have a home with Christ. When he departed from this world, remember what the Lord said. He said, "I will prepare you a place." And remember, you will have a place in heaven. You have a place in heaven. Don't drop down the hope left. Don't drop down your hope right. Don't drop the hope measure. Hold the hope levels up again. Yes, it's threatening outside, but we have a hope in Christ. Paul says, do not be frustrated. Be confused like the rest of mankind without a hope. People around you who do not belong to the same faith you have, they don't know about their tomorrow. They are not sure in their inside of what will happen in moments to come when they die. They don't have that inclination within themselves. It's not there. It does not live. That's why they will go up and down doing this or that. But with you, it must be different. With us, it must be different. Hope. The hope that we do not belong here. The hope which is said in the Bible, when John the island of Patmos, he said, "I saw the new earth coming down. I saw the new city of Jerusalem coming and launch on the new earth." And that is the home of Christian believers. Be reminded of this. That there's a home where you are going. You are, if you die, you will never end up in the grave. If you die, you will never end up in the hands of hell. There's a home special for us. Hallelujah. This is what Paul was talking about, preaching about. Do not be confused. Do not grieve like the rest of mankind who have no hope. We have our hope in the Lord, that our Lord is alive. He's not dead. He was not kept by the grave. He's alive. He rose from the grave. And in the same manner, if we sleep here in grace, when he appears, we will rise again. We will be like him. We'll be changed into new bodies. And we will live with him forever. And when there will be no sorrow, no passion of tears, no sickness there. That must be in your spirit. And be reminded of this. We have another home. We have another world. We have another place far away from this, where there will be no sickness, where there will be no disease, where there will be no pandemic, where there will be no epidemic, where there will be no coronavirus or whatever you call it. It will never be here. For all who hold fast to this faith in Christ Jesus, hallelujah, your hope must be steered. The hope in you must be reinvigorated. Something inside it must say yes to the word of the Lord. It must say yes to the word of truth. If you are not assured in your inside of where you are going, I spoke here last Sunday asking you a question. Where are you going to spend eternity? And that is the hope that we are talking about. As we have done one, cleansed by the Holy Ghost, separated from Christ, we are assured that anything that may happen, coming down to crush this material body, but we have. have a home with Christ. We are not hiding here. We have a home in the Lord. We will never end here. And you will never end up in the grave. As our Lord never ended up in that grave. Hallelujah. And Paul, let this word uplift you. Let this word sustain your hope. Bible says, as Christians, do not conform. What frustrates us is the issue of conformity. Do not conform to the standards of this world.
For this way, you have a future somewhere. This
are 78 or less. You are 88 or less. And you feel like, hey, I've lived long. It's not long. Those years are not too much. Where we are going, through this hope that we have in Christ, where we are going, we are going to live for eternity. Endless. No time limit. Eternity with the Lord. No harm over there. No way. No job seeking over there. No sickness over there. Where we are going, there will be nothing that disturbs which we suffered here on earth, that will suffer again when we meet the Lord. And be encouraged and remain in this very hope. And in this hope, we believe that Christ, by His strength, we are healed. And this we receive through this same hope. Hallelujah. Let me read you another scripture verse. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 7 and 8. It's still Apostle Paul speaking. And he says, but we have this treasure in earthen vessels. He says, listen to me attentively. He says, but we have this treasure. You have a treasure. You are not unwanted. You are not poor being. Don't pity yourself. You have a treasure more than gold. We have treasure. We have this treasure. We have something very important. Maybe you may not consider it important. It's your spirit. It's your life. The life you have is a treasure. He says, we have this treasure in every person. This treasure is placed in this body. And this body is of the material of the earth. It's made from soil, from the ground, from the ground, from the dust. And this body is dust. That's why Paul says it's earthen vessel. It's a matter that the dust is alive. It's a matter that the dust can speak. It's a matter that the dust can move. It's a matter. And all the same, and all the more, it remains an earthen vessel. And inside this vessel, there's a treasure. And which this treasure is you. Of which the treasure is me. Of which this treasure is the Spirit living inside the earthen vessel. We have this treasure in earthen vessel. That the excellence of power may be of God and not for us. He says, we are hard pressed on every side. On every side, we are hard pressed. We are hard pressed. When you come to the left, you are hard pressed. When you come to the right side, you are hard pressed. We are pressed every side. To the front, we are pressed. From the back, we are pressed. We are squeezed. But we are not crushed. We cannot be crushed. I'm speaking with you here that there is a life over there. And where there will be happiness forever. You will be happy year after. For those of you who are writing the caption of this preaching, happy year after. This is not the end. If you drop dead, this is not the end. Being kind is not the end. We will be happy here after. We are crying, we are praying.
be reminded of this. You have a home somewhere. We are perplexed. You can be perplexed. Yes, tormented, frustrated, but never allow the frustration to take its toll inside you. Do not be dismayed. We are perplexed, but not dismayed. You know why he said we are not dismayed? He said we will never drop down the tower. We are not dismayed. We will never let it down. We are not dismayed. For we have a hope that when he appears, we will be like him. Hallelujah. And for this reason, I said to you, be encouraged. We are persecuted, but not forsaken. Every time, every day, and even in the coming years, there will be severe persecution of Christians and the Jews. It's coming. And the Bible forewarned, many will drop down from the faith. When persecution comes, many will drop down from the faith. Do not despair. Paul was told of this, informed of this by the Holy Spirit, that you will be persecuted. We are persecuted, but we are not forsaken. There are times in life when you meet the heaviness or the severe sufferings, we ask ourselves, or even the voice that speaks unto us, that God does not care about your case. God has forsaken you. God does not know you. You are just a patch in the church. You are anointed. Never allow the spirits of the deceiver to move you from the faith. You are not forsaken. And we are not forsaken. The Christian believers of old, they went through hardship. They were burned alive. They went through persecutions. They went through all ordeals of life. But they never forsook their faith in Christ. We are not forsaken. And lastly, Paul says, we are struck down. We are struck down, but not destroyed. That shows that the excellence of power in you is not human origin. It comes from the Lord. There are the member of how many times you passed through the dungeons of life, you went through the valley of the shade of death, and you are still here today. You never thought you would be alive, but you are still here. And that shows the excellence of power. Speak with me. The excellence of power. That shows the excellence of power is not human origin. There's power which comes from God. The excellence of power is not of human origin. It comes from the Lord. That's why you are speaking. You are not forsaken, my brother. You are not forsaken, my sister. Mama, you are not forsaken. Let me speak to you over there, Papa. You are not forsaken. You are not forsaken. The excellence of power is of the Lord. Some of our days we nearly give up. When we feel pain to our body, we think we will never make it. But we are still here. That shows the excellence of power is not of human origin. It comes from the Lord. We are struck down and not destroyed. There are things that push you down. There are things that place you down. And you think it's finished with me. I must tell you, never allow that kind of a spirit to persuade you to believe that it's finished with you. It's not yet over until it's over. Speak with me. is not yet over with me until it's over. This condition will never put me down. This situation will never put me down. It is not yet over until God, who created me and placed me here on this earth, will say it's over. Hallelujah. We are crushed, but we are not destroyed. That means there is a seed inside you which the materials of the earth cannot destroy. And the excellence of power in you is not human origin. It comes from God. There's power that pushes you to and sustains your life almost every time, every day. Hallelujah. Don't be dismayed. Don't lose up, give up. Don't give up. I said, don't give up. And this is the word of God through the mouth of Paul. You will be happy hereafter. You will be happy hereafter. Let me remind you of this. You are Lord Jesus Christ. When he went back to heaven, when he has conquered death, when he has won salvation for humanity, when he arrived to the Father, back to the Father, he was given a name far above all the names. And at the mention of his name, all these, they bow down. All these bow down. At the mention of his name, he's given a position far above all positions except of what the Father. But when he was here, he went through heaviness. He went through sufferings and the death, and even the death of the cross. And remember, he cried on the cross, "Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani?" That was the battle he had on that particular day of carrying your sins, carrying our sins. He died, and he delivered us from all the sorrows. And let this hope never depart from you. And speaking of this hope that we belong to him, and speaking of this hope that we are in this way, speak with me. I am in this way. I am not for this world. I am in the world and not for the world. We are here, not for the world. We belong to him. It will be amazing for us as Christians, who is when they sing in churches, they sing, "We do not belong here." And when the time comes for departure, they are frustrated. Hallelujah. And there's no other method of getting to the Father as outside the church. I'm reading the last scripture verse, Romans chapter 8. Romans chapter 8 and verse 8. And here we go. Verse 8. It's Paul again. Moreover, what we, I must study from 39. For whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. Moreover, whom he predestined, this he also called. And those he called, he also justified. And those he justified, he also glorified. Let me say to you, under the same hope that we have as Christians, that at the end, if you hold
hereafter. You will be happy with the Lord and hereafter. You will celebrate and hereafter. And we are not ending here. And we are, the faith that we have cannot be substituted by any other things. Hold on to your faith. And here Paul says, those whom God has called, as you are called, we are called, speak with me, we are called. Whom God has called, he justified. And he, how did he justify it? Justification, it means, in simple terms, you are no longer guilty. You are justified. When you say, when God says, you are saved, you are blood washed, the guilt is out of you. We are not guilty. We are justified. We are no longer guilty. Even if we pass through other shameful things of this way, when we receive Christ as our Lord and Savior, we are justified. You are justified. Remember this. Speak with me in the name of Jesus. Speak again in the name of Jesus. I am justified. I am no longer carrying the guilt of sin. I am justified. I am not carrying any condemnation. I am justified. We are justified by believing in the Lord Jesus Christ. Believing in his name. He washes our sins away by his blood. And we are justified. And the Paul says, whom God has called, everyone is called, even those in the world who say nothing about the Lord, the rest of mankind, they are all called. They are those who drive themselves away from the word and the voice of the Lord. But still, even those, they are called. They are not special people whom God has called. He called all of us. The call is for all humanity. The call is for all humanity. For all humanity. Everyone, black and white, yellow and green, we are all called to the home in Jesus Christ. And all whom God has called, those he justified. And who are these? The one who answered the call, they are justified. The one who answered the voice of the caller, they are justified. And they are washed by the blood. And now, here comes the last element. And those who are justified, he glorified. And with the glorification will happen when we are alive in the Holy Spirit. Remember what Jesus said. In the last prayer he prayed in John 17, he was asking, he said, glorify me. And glorify, glorify me, glorify. That's the last element with that we must receive, the glorification. The final stage of glorification, where we will be happy here or there after. There will be a moment, endless moment of celebration. Endless moment, there will be no more tears there, which anybody will shed, not in the presence of the Lord, not in the presence of our Savior, no more tears, no more hunger, no more starvation, no more malnutrition, no more any of those kinds, no more and no more. That is when we appear before the Lord. And be encouraged by this. Be encouraged at the hearing of this message. Be encouraged and with understanding. Do not mourn. Do not grieve like the rest of mankind who have no hope. You are a peculiar people. A people with a hope. You are a special human beings of his own creation. We are created in Christ. Set aside for himself. This is who we are in the eye of the Lord. Hallelujah. Let me encourage you this way. Holy Father, I pray to these listeners was there, I pray for them with the same understanding, with Paul had, that nothing will destroy them, nothing will crush them. And I pray in the name of Jesus for the same hope over the entire church of Jesus Christ to understand that we are not forsaken. We have done nothing wrong. We are not forsaken. We are not forsaken. We are not forsaken. We are not forsaken. We know, we understand that every moment of our being here on earth, the Lord is continuously so with us. We are not forsaken. And Lord, we give thee glory, we magnify your name, we exalt your name ever and ever. And with this understanding that we will be happy thereafter in the presence of the Lord.